Welcome to Public Health On Call, a new podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. Our focus is the novel coronavirus. I'm Josh Sharfstein, a faculty member at Johns Hopkins and also a former secretary of Maryland's Health Department. Our goal with this podcast is to bring evidence and experts to help you understand today's news about the novel coronavirus and what it means for tomorrow. If you have questions, you can email them to publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. That's publichealthquestion@jhu.edu for future podcast episodes. This new podcast has been downloaded more than 1.5 million times over the past 5 months, thanks to listeners like you. Next week, we'll be launching season 2 of the podcast, bringing you more evidence and experience about a broader range of topics, including but not limited to COVID-19. This week, we're checking in with some of the people we interviewed in some of our most powerful episodes from season 1. Today, Stephanie Desmon speaks to Emily Gurley, a Johns Hopkins epidemiologist who developed a wildly popular course on contact tracing and has a new one coming out soon. They discuss the desperate need for better contact tracing and the real challenges preventing contact tracing from having the impact it could in stemming the transmission of COVID-19. Let's listen.
Thank you so much for joining me.
It's my pleasure, Stephanie.
We last spoke about contact tracing a while back now, so could you please remind our listeners what it is and why it's so important during COVID?
Sure. Contact tracing is a tried and true public health strategy whereby you find people who are infected and ask them to change their behavior so that they don't infect others. And you find the people that they've had contact with who may have been infected and also ask them to change their behavior so that they don't go on to infect anyone else. And that's particularly important for COVID because you can be infectious without knowing it. Many people, you know, infect others just the day before they get sick. You can be quite infectious. So this is an important strategy for slowing the spread of COVID-19. And so this is one of the best tools we have to try to control spread. Countries that have managed to reduce transmission down to quite low levels, this has been a key part of their strategy. So something that we're trying to do in the United States as well.
So once people know that they may have been infected, they know to be tested, to quarantine themselves.
Right. So testing is an important part of this. People who think they may have it should get tested. And then people who are sick, who are diagnosed with COVID are asked, we say that they're asked to isolate themselves from others. And then their contacts are asked to quarantine. So quarantine is something that you do when you're healthy. You don't know whether you've been infected or not, right? And so you need to change your behavior anyway because you've been exposed. So that's quarantine is for contacts and isolation is for cases.
Great. And since we last spoke, you've had a very successful course on contact tracing. Can you tell us about that success and what people are doing with this new knowledge?
So that's right. We, with support from Bloomberg Philanthropies, we created a course to lay out the basics of contact tracing for COVID. And the idea behind this course was that many places wanted to ramp up their contact tracing programs. And they, in order to do that, they would need to hire many people to fill these jobs, to do this work. And those people may not have any background in public health or infectious diseases. So the idea was to create a basics course so that someone could go through the course even before they were ever hired. But they would be starting with the baseline knowledge on key things like how is this virus transmitted? What is contact tracing and how does it work? What are the steps in contact tracing? What are some of the ethical considerations? And how do you have an effective conversation with someone? Because at the end of the day, contact tracers, that's what they do. They have to communicate with people. They have to listen to people and be able to give them information that they need to change behavior. So The course launched in May. We've had more than 500,000 people enroll. There have been more than 200,000 people to complete the course and get a certificate. And it's been translated into many languages, and other programs have taken the materials and adapted them for their own use in their own, you know, cultural context, which is really inspiring. It's clear fairly early on that this was more than a course. Clearly, many states and cities and countries were using it to help build up their public health workforce, which was our primary intended audience for the course. But we've also heard from so many people who took the course just to understand what contact tracing was, just wanted to feel empowered about what they could be doing and how the virus is transmitted. I think there's a real hunger for credible information about what was happening and what people could do. So it's been successful beyond what we had envisioned, which is very gratifying.
So what do we know about the impact of contact tracing on transmission of COVID?
So we know that in theory could stop, you know, transmission through a contact tracing program if it were large enough and fast enough to find everyone who's infected and all their contacts. We know that countries that have had major successes in controlling transmission, contact tracing is a key strategy. No one has done it without strong contact tracing programs. So contact tracing is just, you know, it's one of the tools that we use, but it's a really important one. In the United States, you know, the commitment to contact tracing programs, to getting them to the scale and speed that we need, has really varied by state and by jurisdiction. And I think it's clear across the United States right now, there are very few places that have the programs, the interventions in place to really keep transmission under control. The case numbers show us that that's not true. So we've really got to dig in and figure out what can we do to stop the spread. Contact tracing has to be a part of that. But there are other interventions to reduce the number of contacts that people have every day that have to go along with it. We are not at a point in the United States where we can continue on with life as usual and just have, you know, one program that's going to solve everything.
And that's, I think, what's making it so complicated at this point, is that at the beginning, there were shutdowns a lot of places, and now very little is shut down.
Right. Well, the idea with the shutdown is that you bring transmission under control because you limit all the opportunities for the virus to spread. Okay. Not all. Many. Right. And that worked. But the problem is that's also, so by asking folks to stay home, you are limiting transmission, right? You're bringing the numbers down, but at the same time, you have to be ramping up the other public health programs to meet the need of the cases that you have. And if you don't have that in place before you open up, which obviously did not happen in many places, then as soon as you open up, you'll see case numbers go right back up because there's no intervention in place, right? The intervention was staying home. Once you get rid of that intervention, if you haven't done anything else to be more targeted, then you should expect to see the same thing again.
It makes contact tracing work really hard.
Contact tracing work is always really hard. There's no easy silver bullet solution. It's always really hard. But you can't ask people to do the impossible, right? You know, the contact tracing team that you need when there's very little transmission will certainly be overwhelmed with case numbers that go even higher. So you have to resource these programs enough so that they succeed, and you also have to help them out, right? There have to be interventions in place to try to limit the number of contacts that people have every day and to be smart about that. And that includes social distancing. It includes wearing face coverings in public. Those things have to be in place. we are still not there with testing. Contact tracing can only work if you find cases. I think access to testing is better than it has been, right? We got better with the access part, but the delays for getting test results back are still such that they make the test itself really useless for public health prevention. Because by the time the test result comes back, well, those people have already infected other people and, you know, contact tracing hasn't started. So we still do not have our act together for the most part.
So you're working on a new course. Can you tell me about that?
I'm delighted to tell you about that. There are many places that have really invested in contact tracing programs. And, you know, I think we really have to be humble here. As I mentioned, it's difficult work and we've never done it at this, again, the scale and the speed that we need for COVID-19. Like any program, you know, you have to start and you have to learn. This has to be a learning exercise. And there are guidelines out there about targets you want to try to hit. Everyone knows you want to try to be as complete as possible and finding cases and contacts. Everyone knows you want to be as fast as possible and finding cases and contacts. Great. But how fast do you have to be? How complete do you have to be? It's a dynamic system. And so there's no one indicator you can point to say, all right, this program is working. We also have problems with the definition of what is working. What does working mean? What do we mean when we say this program is working or isn't working? We're not very good yet at talking about what we mean by working. And so this course tries to address both of those things. So in collaboration with colleagues here at the School of Public Health and the Infectious Disease Dynamics Group led by Justin Lessler, they've been doing a lot of modeling of, well, dynamic transmission models of infection in the United States. Because we knew that contact tracing is such an important intervention, they began modeling how contact tracing changes transmission. And we knew that this could be a really important tool for contact tracing programs to measure their impact, right? So first we sort of set out the change in transmission or the change in the reproductive number as a metric for measuring impact of contact tracing. So this gives us a way to talk about impact, right? Beyond just how fast are you, how complete are you? Really, we want to get to your impact on transmission. And many of us know, right, the reproductive number gives us a sense for how it's basically the average number of cases that each case will infect. So it gives us a sense for what the trajectory of the outbreak is going to be, which is important. And this is really what contact tracing is trying to stop, right? It's trying to stop transmission. So the reproductive number is a really good way to think about impact of contact tracing and how effective it is. I'll just pause for a minute and say that I think many people look at transmission happening now and they say, well, there's a contact tracing program that's in place and we have this level of transmission. You know, they're comparing the level of transmission that we have to zero transmission or very little transmission and saying the gap between what we have now and zero is big. That means the contact tracing program doesn't work. What we really have to be thinking about is where would transmission be if we did not have a contact tracing program? So we're not comparing what we have now to zero. We're comparing what we have now to what we would have if we didn't have any contact tracing. And so the core sort of sets out that framework of thinking about impact of contact tracing programs so that we're getting the framing right. And then it also introduces an application, an easy to use application that's an interface between public health programs and this infectious disease model. So essentially what programs can do is they get some metrics out of their own program. How many cases do they find? How many contacts do they find? How quickly do they find them? They enter that into the application. And the application then basically on the back, you know, on the backside customizes the model for them and gives them an estimate of the impact they're having on the reproductive number. So what would the reproductive number be without your intervention, and where is it with your intervention? So that, you know, first of all, programs can recognize that they are having an impact. Even very incomplete, slow contact tracing programs are having some impact. And I think it's important for them to be able to see that and recognize that. Second, the second really important thing that the app helps them do is it provides figures and reports that they can use to strategize about how to get better. There are so many moving parts to a contact tracing program. Again, it's not intuitive about where you should look first to try to improve the program. And so we hope that this will give, you know, these very hardworking programs a better sense of where they should push first to improve their impact. And for many programs, that's going to be finding more cases.
I could talk about this all day, but unfortunately we're out of time. Emily Gurley, thank you so much.
Thanks.
Thank you for listening to Public Health on Call, a new podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. Please send questions to be covered in future podcasts to publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. This podcast is produced by Josh Sharfstein, Lindsay Smith-Rogers, and Lamare Morales. Audio production by Niall Owen McCusker and Spencer Greer, with support from Chip Hickey. Distribution by Nick Moran. Thank you for listening.